Hey guys, welcome back to my channel, and it's Star Trek Picard time once again. Episode number 4, Absolute Candor. So when we left off the third episode, we saw how where Picard was at that particular time. The first three episodes are basically, I think everybody should look at it as three parts of one giant episode as to introducing where Picard is right now, what's going on with him, the reasons for him going back into space, and finding out that things are very different right now. He doesn't seem to have many friends in the in Starfleet, and he's going to have to do things his own way, like a rogue group of people that's going to have to do the mission that he wants them to do. So he's building up his team now. So we have four of them, including Picard, Raffi, his estranged former lieutenant, you've got Rios, the captain of the ship, swashbuckling, smart-ass, guy who doesn't care about rules and stuff, and you've got Agnes Jurani, the brain power, the expert on synthetics. So now he needs muscle, he needs a person who he can rely on for doing the killing if and when needed. So that's basically the him setting out to this particular planet in this episode. So we get the what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about the events regarding Picard, and then the rest part of the of this video is going to be talking about things happening on the Borg cube with the Romulans and Soji. So when we start the episode, Picard has asked Rios to go to another planet known as Vashti, which is a settlement that was created after the problems on the Romulan planet. So it's mainly humans and Romulans, although I don't remember seeing any humans in it, but they do mention the word Terrans, and there's a racial element also happening which we'll speak about soon. Picard's on their hollow suite, having had a set of his study in his chateau recreated, along with one of the holograms that's basically looks like Rios. And Raffi comes in and says, why this detour? She wants to go straight to Free Cloud, so that they can go and meet Bruce Marek. So he says he's looking for someone to join the mission from Vashti. Vashti is this planet, kind of like it reminds me of a desert planet, something like maybe like even Morocco or something like that. And there were these flashback to 14 years ago where Picard is well known among the Romulan survivors as someone who's trying to help them. He's greeted very fondly when he beams onto the planet, and he goes to meet this this group of Romulan nuns. I like the fact that there's a lot of things being added to Romulan culture, a lot of things we didn't even know about. They're added, or maybe even heard pieces of here and there, but they're actually branched out quite a bit over here. They're known as the Koat Milat. It's holy women. They're a sacred group of warrior nuns. They're extremely efficient at killing people and stuff. But they're also a little bit into religion and things like that. So they're also sworn enemies of the Tal Shiar, and Picard has become friends with them. He's been trying to help a lot of them settle. There is a lone male child in the along with the nuns. His name is Elnor, and Picard sort of becomes like a father figure to him. He teaches him how to fence. He reads him stories about the Three Musketeers and tells him about Data and Data's cat. And we see him bonding with the kid almost like a parent, or maybe even a grandparent, because he is much older than the kid. The kid is around 14 years old, and that's when the he's spending a lot of time with them. He seems to be comfortable with these people. And then he hears, he's contacted by Raffi, not shown on that particular scene, but she contacts him and says that, you know, the Mars has been attacked. So he has to go back, and unfortunately, because of the issues that happened, he never returns. So the Romulans now, 14 years later, see him as a hated figure, as someone who had promised to help them. He made a lot of promises, but he didn't fulfill them, so they don't like him anymore. Elnor feels abandoned because he was beginning to bond with Picard. He was an orphan, so he was beginning to bond like a son to Picard. And that's a big change from where we know Picard from TNG, where he didn't like kids. But of course, that changed. You know, it was a gradual progression after his. There were a couple of episodes where he wasn't comfortable with kids, but he still didn't warm up to them. I remember that episode. I don't remember the name of it, but I do remember where he's stuck with three kids and they're trying to get back the ship, and he has to teach them Faro Shaka, which is a French song, a folk song, to try and control them, calm them down. And then, of course, in the movie Star Trek Generations, he hears the news of his son, Rene, being killed, and he's very sad because, like, you know, the family line will kind of, if he doesn't have kids, and he feels like he's way past that period where, like, you know, he's going to have a family, and the Picard name will actually die out with him. So it's kind of, you know, he's changed quite a bit from the 1987 Picard that we see him in the beginning part of the first episode of TNG. So that's a gradual change. So anyway, the Romulans don't see, they felt betrayed that he didn't come back. Except for the nuns, they kind of welcome him back almost the same. And he goes to ask for a warrior, and he sees Elnor, who is now a proficient warrior. He's got a Romulan sword and stuff, so he taught him how to fence, and from that on he took lessons with the nuns, and he's the only male warrior in their clan. So he asks him to join up with him, but he refuses because he believes Picard is only asking him. He never came back for the young boy. He's here now only because he needs him, and it's not out of anything else, not like a feeling of you know, fondness or anything like that. So on present day, so he leaves. Picard initially leaves, and he's thinking about going back. There is a small window gap in between in Vashti, where the planet is fortified. It's got its huge kind of like a force field around it. So there's only a small gap in between where he can actually beam down. So he beams down in one period, and it takes I think around 30 minutes or so, and he gets another minute in between to actually beam back up. So while he has to wait a few minutes, so he goes and sees this bar kind of setting, and it's they've got a sign called Romulan Soli. I wonder why it was in English, the same thing like on the ball cube. And I'm guessing that we'll have to, you know, remove that from our mind and think that it's basically what we're seeing is the English translation. So I think they could have done that a little better. Having spent many years watching Star Trek, where they actually do show different language and stuff like that, they should have actually done that better. But it says Romulans only. So there's kind of a racial tension between the Terrans, humans, and Romulans on that planet. And it's kind of a deserted, it's a little bit like, you know, they're living under squalor kind of situations. They're not as prosperous as they were supposed to be. As they were supposed to be when he first visited them. So they're kind of in the midst of some an area where there's a lot of tension and stuff, and that led to them building the force field around the planet. And there is an old bird of prey from the TOS era, bird of prey, TOS and Enterprise as well, kind of almost. That's going around the planet. So while he's waiting and beamed up, he goes to the bar and he removes the sign and he asks for some service, but he doesn't get it. And there's an ex-Romulan senator who comes and he threatens Picard and tells him that, you know, you abandoned us and all that stuff. And he takes a couple of swords and they're about to fight it off. Picard initially defends himself, but then he throws down the sword and says, I'm not going to fight you and all that stuff. And when Picard is being held back and almost killed, Elnor comes to his rescue and chops up. He tells the senator, I'm giving you a choice to either live or die. And that seems to be the way of the warriors, so of that particular particular clan. So the senator decides to attack, and Elnor chops his head off, and you see green blood coming out. So apparently Elnor has changed his mind, seeing Picard in trouble. He came to his rescue, and then he decides to join up with Picard. Picard later tells him that, like, you know, it's under strict orders. Only if I give you the order to actually kill somebody are you supposed to go and attack them fatally. Otherwise, no, it's only defense purposes. They are beamed up before some of the other Romulans can shoot them with disruptor weapons. They're beamed up and beamed back to the ship, and they're under attack. However, there's a small ship, strange ship that comes out of in nowhere. They don't know who the person is. They come and try to help them, and they're able to destabilize basically cripple the bird of prey. But however, that small ship is damaged very badly, and it's about to get about to blow up. So they beam the pilot onto the ship, and lo and behold, it's 7 of 9. And absolutely wonderful to see Jeri Ryan back in her role as 7 of 9. We love her. I think she's a favorite for Star Trek fans. Definitely a big favorite of Star Trek Voyager fans. And I think a lot of science fiction fans kind of love her. She was awesome. She is still awesome. She looks absolutely ravishing in her 50s. And long may that continue. She's an absolute delight to watch on the screen, both for visually as well as her acting skills. She's got a good presence, I must say. I don't think she's going to win an Oscar award in any of her stuff. Having said that, I would prefer to watch her over several Oscar-winning actresses. She is amazing. She is an absolutely wonderful, delightful addition to the show. I must say, we already knew she was coming, but at the same time, it is actually wonderful to see her on screen. So I'm having, I must say, even though the show is shot show is released on, I think, Thursday night in India. On Friday. I'm able to watch it on Saturday. Thursday night or Friday. Thursday in the US, Friday over here in India. I'm able to see it only after, my work schedule being what it is. So I'm happy that I could have watched it late last night as soon as I came, and I think I reached home around 2:45, no, around 3 a.m. I came a little early yesterday, but I didn't want to start watching it and then fall asleep, as I have been falling asleep quite frequently. Seem to need more sleep. Anyhow, so that's all the part about Picard, and then we also seen the scenes on the Borg cube where Narek and I keep forgetting their name, Soji and the Romulan guy, what's his name? Narek, yes. Yeah, so they both are talking, and then he says, hey, I'm going to take you to a particular part of the Borg cube where there's a ritual that actually happens, and they both start sliding on the surface, removing their shoes or something like that. And it's a kind of like a cutesy moment. They both have a little romantic scene between them, getting close and stuff. But he annoys her a little bit later, and so she leaves. We catch up with Narek and his sister while he's sleeping. She actually comes into the... He's having a nightmare, and while they're coming to the... While he wakes up, he sees that his sister is actually over there. And this is not me or other people thinking that there's something weird going on, but there is a very, very strong vibe of incest going on between the two brothers, between the brother and sister, and what do you call it? It's weird. There's this he's manipulating Soji to try and get to know about the existence or the whereabouts of these of the synthetics colony, and without making her activator the way that Dodge was activated, and that's why he's so. But he's actually falling in love with her. I think it's kind of plain to see, and then his sister doesn't like it at all. She's she's not happy that he's not getting the details much quicker. The success rate, she feels the success is very slow. The progress is very slow. That's what I was looking for. Lieutenant Rizzo is what I still know her as, but yeah. So she's like, and she's pretty powerful. She chokes him, telling him that he's got one more week left, and within that week, if he doesn't get the results needed, she is going to take her own methods to find out the details, and he's not going to like it. So, like, you know, pull up your socks, kind of like go get the deep thing done. If not, I intervene. And there is a lot of that's what they were saying, Cersei and Jamie Lannister vibe. And that's kind of weird for Star Trek to actually go there, but since we are looking at things more darker, I guess why not? But I'm not sure. I'm not sure how I like this particular dynamic between those two. I mean, it's okay to see them being confrontational and she being the more tougher, ruthless soldier kind of thing. Whereas he is the more scientific, geeky kind of person. That's cool, pretty much. I don't have a problem with it. It's just the incest vibe, is not making me... I don't like that part that much. This episode is actually directed by Jonathan Frakes, who is also directing the next episode. And I'm guessing that's the episode in which we see Marina Sirtis and Jonathan Frakes reprise their role as Riker and Deanna Troi, I'm really looking forward to that. But the fact is, the show needs to step up the pace a little bit more. I did feel there was elements of that over here, and I'm liking the story so far. I wish the episodes were much longer. I mean, it's on it's a streaming service; they could have definitely done an hour. It's this episode in particular. I think last episode was my favorite so far. This one would be a close second along with the first episode. So I'm going to give this maybe an 8.5 out of 10. I'm still liking it a lot. But last episode, I think, was much better. I'm missing the two Romulans, Zaman and Laris. So, of course, I do miss the fact that we don't get to see the puppy anymore in the show. So, yeah, that's my recap about this particular episode. We're getting to see Picard seeing that, you know, things are very, very different from what he knew. And then the fact that he could not live up to the expectations of several people. He is seeing the repercussions of those. And he's also feeling some guilt. There is some guilt feeling that he could not actually do more. And there's a line in it saying that you couldn't save everyone, so you decide to save no one. But I think up till Nemesis era Picard, we would never have seen him give up. But he is much older during the scenes that you see 14 years ago. He's a much older man then, and of course he's in his 90s. In the current era that we're seeing him, so I can actually see why he would have actually given up. So it's a moment to really blame, but yeah, there's a lot of mystery and a lot of issues that's happening on it. I would like to see some Klingons. I don't know, are they going to what way they're going to go the Klingons with? Are they going to see the Discovery era Klingons? Are you going to see proper Klingons? Because it's going to look really weird if you don't see proper Klingons. I still call them proper Klingons. Alright, so 8.5, not a bad episode. Take care, good night, and live long and prosper.